No matter how the world changes, life is still bound by desires and worries, needs and wishes, love and loathing. The rapid development of science and technology has benefited all of us. But it has also introduced new problems. Is the gulf in demands between man and nature, living creatures and machines, the one that can be reconciled? Can the new technologies that empower us also offer us wisdom for life? This is another problem for which scientists are trying to map a pathway to the future. A patient in Ningbo has a badly worn meniscus, which leaves him unable to stand. The doctors have decided it's best to replace it. When we move the meniscus, a piece of cartilage between the femur and the tibia protects the joint and allows it to move freely. If the meniscus becomes worn, it can't repair itself, so an artificial implant is the most effective treatment currently available.
人工关节的话，人类已经探索了100多年的历史，那么什么材料都用过，最早用木材、用橡牙、用金属、用玻璃都尝试过。
Fu Jun's team is trying to improve the longevity of artificial joints. They are using olefin, a new type of high-strength, wear-resistant polypropylene. But there is another problem. The human body is like a chemical factory in which materials gradually oxidize. The artificial meniscus will become brittle or even perforated. So in addition to high strength and resistance to wear, it needs to be inoxidizable. No matter how science and technology advance, nature will always be our greatest teacher. After years of research, Fu Jun has finally found what he needed in a nut, the gallnut. The natural antioxidant extracted from gallnuts increases the antioxidant capacity of the olefin material by 10 times and reduces the wear by 80%. With these improvements, the artificial joint can be expected to last for up to 30 years. In science fiction, bionic bodies implanted with special materials can gain superhuman strength. Is this just fantasy? From Fu Jun's point of view, this idea is both unrealistic and lacking in vision. He wants to find new materials that can empower our body tissues to regenerate.
它给细胞的生长提供一个环境，并且呢，能够分泌出我们的关节软骨素。 如果这个成功的话，以后就没有人工关节了。
啊，这个明显的就现在就按下去了。
对，
它会自动的还原吗？
对，
自动的做。
有难度，但是目前呢，我们看到了非常让人兴奋的一些进展。真正的走向临床，我们觉得还需要至少十年以上的时间。
Maybe years from now, this new material, hydrogel, will be inside many of us. Implanted with microsurgery, it will help regenerate cartilage.
我们现在可能是处在一个分水岭，在这之前的材料都是这种无生命的材料，再往后呢，一定会发展到这种有生命的材料，或者是类生命的材料，那么我们也叫它智能材料。这是一个非常前沿的方向，全世界的科学家们在努力的一个方向。
In the laboratory, the material has, at different temperatures, already been able to perform certain moves on its own, as if it were living matter. What will the future bring? Even the scientists can't predict. Perhaps the only thing that seems sure is that the one distinct boundary between lifeless artifacts and the magic of nature is melting away with scientific advance. Factories, like nature, can themselves produce organic life. This lettuce is full grown. In 2 hours, it will be on the supermarket shelf in Xiamen. It grew without the aid of sunlight or soil. This is a plant factory.
自然界的光合作用，那就是植物利用太阳光能来合成有机物，那是在天然条件下。但是在植物工厂内，完全是用 LED 的人工照明。绿色中来讲，蓝光和红光加一点绿光以后啊，还反而防止植物的衰老，增加产量。所以光培方法是植物工厂里头关键核心技术。
85-year-old Kuang Ting Yun is the scientific advisor to the factory. She and her team from the Chinese Academy of Sciences Institute of Botany devised this technology.
这个工厂是10,000平方米，是目前是国际上最大的植物工厂。
Kuang Ting Yun has made a simple calculation. If each person consumes an average of 200 grams of vegetables per day, the factory can supply 10,000 people with fresh vegetables. Its cultivation capacity is 100 times that of traditional farming, while using just 1% of the land area. Small plant factories could be built in our own homes, and the saved land resources could be returned to nature.But it's not limited to this.
它能满足于潜艇、军舰、海岛、高寒的特殊区域的国防战略的需要，航天、航空，乃至今后移民到别的星球。
Can we build a plant factory in outer space?Another scientist is at work on the project.
我们要把植物在太空当中给它种好了是不容易的。像那个植物呢，它根它总是扎向地上，叶子跟那个枝啊，它总是向空气当中伸展啊。主要是地球上存在着一种叫重力。如果到空间它是没有重力的，它就必须要有个再适应的过程。
Putting plants into simulated microgravity and observing their behavior is the first step. More importantly, in the laboratory, scientists can use genetic engineering to control the time of blossoming.
控制开花很重要，比如说我们平时吃的绿叶蔬菜，我们就不希望它早开花，我们让它开花晚一点，它多长叶子。然后像粮食作物，比如说水稻，那你就希望它早开花，这样就会生产更多的粮食。当你把这个都研究透了以后啊，你就可以为人类提供食物、氧气跟水，我们就可以带着这样的干粮啊去那个更远的地方。
点火。
The Tiangong 2 Space Laboratory was launched successfully on September 15, 2019. Rice and thalecress were carried on board. They blossomed and bore seeds in space. This might be the first step of mankind's greatest leap. In the popular movie The Wandering Earth, humans roam through space carrying the Earth with them.But practically speaking, scientists think it more realistic to travel in the space with food. A self-sufficient space station, a space farm on the moon, or even on Mars, may one day cease to be science fiction. Guo Huadong is confident of this.He is a remote sensing expert who studies the Earth, but needs to gather his data from space. Scientific instruments carried by remote sensing satellites can collect so much previously unknown data and information about our planet.
我们表面看很平滑的沙漠，如果用雷达去看的话，很可能就看到沙漠下面的一些水啊。其他的资源呀，等等，就像咱们在医院做 CT 一样，为人类呢提供更强有力的、更科学的手段，进行地球的环境的监测、资源的探测。
Several years ago, Guo Huadong came up with a bright idea. If we use the moon, the Earth's natural satellite, as an observatory, and set up remote sensing equipment there.We can collect data more stably and widely than from man-made satellites.
地球它是一个很大的东西，就像盲人摸象一样。你这个卫星看到的话，永远是一条腿，一个耳朵，看到的只是它的一部分。我们如果能够一下子把它全看见，它必然会带来很多全新的这个知识。
今天人类进入大数据时代，当你问我什么是数字地球的时候。那么我们觉得地球大数据就是数字地球。
其实人的理念的挑战是最重要的。你只要分析透这件事能够为人类带来利益的话，没有钱可以有钱，没有技术可以有技术。技术很多时候都是被逼出来的。
Guo Huadong is so excited about the future that he has written a letter to the moon.
1969年7月21日，人类的脚印第一次印在你的土地上。即便如此，你依旧存在着许多秘密，正如你的背面充满着神秘。当然，你不是我们探索宇宙的终点。只会是一个美丽的中转站。相信到了那个时候，我们也会在另一个星球，以一个旁观者的角度，把你看得更加清楚。
Sometimes serious scientists are more romantic than the rest of us. For them, the future is not a fantasy, but a dream that starts right here.Right now, in the laboratory.
Look at 流星划过夜空，我们希望知道它到底是怎么回事。人类啊，对于未知的探索，这是一个天性。
人类不都总得有这些梦吗？是吧？千百年来，人类就是因为我们有这个梦，才不断的去探索新的知识，突破这个认知的边界。
肯定是停掉了，因为真空变畅了。
不是，它怎么停了呀？
不太清楚为什么停了吗？就
搞的话，只能我们机器人看嘛。
Accidents can happen every day in these experiments because the device being used is extremely big and complicated.
它就启动不起来。等一会儿吧，它这泵有可能是温度过高保护了。
This glitch is only a temporary difficulty compared with the grand mission they want to accomplish. It's part of an international project involving 7 countries and regions. It's aimed at building a controllable nuclear fusion reactor. If controllable nuclear fusion can be harnessed, we will have infinite clean energy, like that of the sun.
聚变的原料主要从海水里面提取。一升海水里面可提取到，如果能够完全发生聚变反应，它释放的能量相当于300升汽油释放的能量。
这次等离子的放电，大概如果正常的话，应该是维持10秒钟。3、2、1、0。
In 2006, Chinese scientists first succeeded in their experiments with physical discharging. In 2018.The team raised the temperature to 1 million degrees for 10 seconds for the first time.
这次表现非常好，就是我们所期望的。
This breakthrough raised expectations for the scientists' work.
那真的明天再试一下。
But it's not clear when we will be able to use the electricity generated from a fusion reactor. The only thing for sure.Is that the current development of science and technology is like a fusion reactor that keeps increasing in temperature. Science and technology are accumulating energy and seeking another breakthrough.
科学技术发展有时候是确实很难预料，是吧？但是有几个方向的进一步的发展和突破的话呢，确实会来带来一个社会的一个巨大的进步。清洁能源、生命科学、新材料、信息领域。人工智能的这个发展，它有可能会带来一些非常巨大的变化。
对于量子计算、引力波，很多世界上最前沿的东西，总书记非常的关注。他的敏锐的洞察力，使我们确实深受教育。他也是指示我们呢，这个能够不断的去面向世界的科技前沿，来努力的去创新。
In all of these possible battlefields, scientists from all over the world have started a fierce competition. Chinese scientists, of course, are not to be left behind, because this will determine the fate of China. Even if prospects seem dim today, they have to go all out.
有一只猫啊，在我们的每天生活里面，这只猫呢只能处于呢死或者活的状态，但到了微观世界呢，这只猫呢可以处于呢死和活状态两个状态的相干叠加。
The state of being both dead and alive is impossible in reality, but in the quantum world, many principles defy our common sense. As such,Quantum mechanics is considered one of the most difficult scientific theories to understand. Pan Jianwei was fascinated by it as soon as he got a whiff of it as a young man. His dream is to build a top-class quantum laboratory in China. Here, quantum computing, the hottest technology in the world, is being studied.
基于量子叠加原理的一种计算的机器我们就把它叫做呢量子计算机。
A quantum computer can deal with multiple tasks simultaneously, so computing speeds soar compared to traditional computers.
如果要来求解一个大数分解，需要花150000年，你才能把这个问题求解完。但是如果你能够有一个量子手机，它只需要滴答1秒钟。
The development of quantum computing is challenging, and no one knows which way they should go. So Pan Jianwei set up 2 teams to develop this technology with 2 different approaches, photon, and superconductivity. In 2019, one of the teams produced a superconducting quantum computing chip and established a world record.
它的操控的一个能量尺度呢，比一个蝴蝶扇动一下翅膀只有它的十亿亿分之一这样一个能量尺度。它如果有一个千分之一的扰动，就会让这个整个量子的信息完全丧失掉。我其实最担心的是这个事情，所以整个这个系统呢，我们是要放到这样一个极低温、极低噪声的一个测控环境里面的。在中间的这个芯片呢，大概只有指甲盖大小。
The other route seems even more promising. In 2017, they invented the first original model photon computer.
这个系统呢，可能跟大家想象中的计算机的样子是完全不一样的。我们想象中要么像个台式机，要么是一个笔记本，对吧？我们可以看到，我们现在大概三平方米的整个的这个空间里面，都是我们整个这个系统。When
the first general purpose computer was built 73 years ago, it occupied a room of over 160 square meters. Now, a laptop will fit easily into a backpack. How long will it be before we see a general-purpose quantum computer? No one can say for sure. Due to quantum mechanics' complexity and its deviation from common sense, Pan Jianwei is often doubted and challenged. But science has made him optimistic and receptive. To him, each one of us is the most incredible creature in the vastness of the universe.
我们的宇宙是从某个基点爆炸，炸出了原子、分子、万物。 然后经过100多年的进化，才进化出来我们这个地球，我们有这么些人的存在，然后还能反过来研究我们自然界，哎，来畅想这个宇宙，是吧？我觉得这是一个非常值得珍惜的事情。这么多原子能够构成我一个潘建伟，这么多原子构成个你，能够坐在一起来讨论科学的力量，本身这就是一个非常小的概率事件。
Earth is a gorgeous blue planet, but also a limited world. Science has empowered us to be stronger than we have ever been and to create a better future. But the future is always uncertain. If we could turn back the clock to the year 2000, what kind of future did you fantasize about as you ushered in the new century? Did you think of the popularity of e-commerce and the transformation of means of payment? Did you think that phone and computer would be combined into a smart device of palm size? What if we went back to the 1980s, 1900s, or 1800s? What would people then have imagined for the future? To what extent have those fantasies become a reality? The future not only belongs to science and scientists, but is also in the hands of each of us. Every one of the 7.5 billion people on this blue planet will create the future. Our joint efforts will build a brighter future.